Hello everyone. In this video, we will discuss Go programming, an advanced method in linear programming. The purpose of Go programming method is to solve multi-criteria decision problems. In reality, the decision makers have to deal with situations in which there are multiple goals, and therefore, decision makers have to set the priority for each goal and find the solution that satisfies these goals in order of the priority. This is very effective and also a popular method in dealing with multiple criteria decision problems. In this video, I'm going to use a very simple example in the textbook to explain this method. So this is a very simple example in investment decisions on page 660. I will summarize this problem briefly so you will understand the situation. This is an investment advising company, and it is trying to advise a client on investment decision. The client has $80,000. There are two investment options on stock: the US oil stock or hub property stock. These stock options have different prices: $25 per share for US oil and $50 per share for hub properties. They also have different annual return per share. For example, for US oil stock, the annual return is $3 per share, and for hub properties, the annual return is $5 per share. Each investment option has a risk index also per share, and you can see that annual rate of return for hub properties is $5 per $50, which is 10%. And for US oil, the annual rate of return is $3 per $25, which is 12%. Please note that the investment option with higher rate of return has higher risk index. For example, risk index for US oil is 0.5 per share, while risk index for hub properties is 0.25 per share. Higher risk index values mean greater risk of investment. This is a simple investment problem, and the client faces two sides of the decision. One side is the investment rate of return. The more you invest, the higher rate of returns you will receive. But of course, you have limited funds, so you have to decide how many shares of stocks you should buy. On the other hand, risk investment must be considered. The stock with a higher rate of return has higher risk. It is important to make sure the total risk index can be controlled so that it does not exceed a certain value. In this problem, we assume that the client is very concerned about the risk of investment, and the client wants to set a goal that the maximum risk index that he or she can accept is 700 or less. That means the total risk index should not exceed 700. Another goal, of course, involves total annual return. The client wants to have an annual return of at least $9,000. Thus, we have two major goals: find the portfolio with a maximum risk index of 700 and at least $9,000 of the total annual return. This is a decision problem that we see every day in any business areas, and we have to solve it. We have two goals, but it's hard to balance them. Thus, in this case, the client has set the priorities. The primary goal, or also called the priority level 1, is the risk index to contain the risk. In other words, the priority level 1 is to keep the risk index under 700. And this is the most important priority. And once the risk index does not exceed 700, the secondary goal, also called the priority level 2, is to achieve the total annual return of at least $9,000. These goals are called preemptive goals. That means there's no trade-off. The primary goal cannot be sacrificed to meet the secondary goal. So you know the primary goal or the priority level 1 must be met first, and that's a condition in this case. So how can we solve it? We are using the so-called goal programming method. To develop a goal programming, we set the goals. We have the primary goal or priority level 1, we call it goal 1, which about total risk index. The secondary goal or the priority level 2, we call it goal 2, which is about the annual return. As the way we started with linear programming, we define the variables, even though in this case, we'll have to add some more variables later. Major variables for this problem include the number of shares in each stock that the client should buy. So let's call U is the number of shares of US oil to be purchased. And secondly, H is the number of shares of hub properties to be purchased. These are typical decision variables we have in this model. Let's set the goal equations because we have two different goals in this case. As you can see in other examples, we may face 5 or 6 different goals. In this case, we have only 2 different goals. Let's set the goal for the priority level 1. The goal 1 states that the total risk index should be 700 or less. So to have a mathematical expression for the total risk, we use risk index per share. 0.5 is the risk index per share for the US oil, and 0.25 is the risk index per share for hub properties. So we have 0.5 U plus 0.25 H, that's the total risk index. And the goal is to have the total risk index of no more than 700, or at most 700. Now, this is not a constraint, so we don't put less than or equal to here. We have to write the goal equations in a different way. Instead of writing less than equal to 700, we add 2 additional variables. We call them deviation variables in this equation. The first one is D1 plus, and the second one is D1 minus. So we write plus D1 plus minus D1 minus. These are 2 new variables we have to add to this model. So what's the D1 plus? I use capital D to ensure the consistency. D1 plus is the amount by which the risk index exceeds the target variable. Because the target variable is 700, D1 plus is the amount by which the total risk index exceeds the target variable. So we add that to the right hand side of the equation. We can clearly see that the lower D1 plus, the better, because we want to contain the risk. We also have D1 minus, which is the amount by which the total risk index is less than the target value of 700. So for every goal, we'll have to use these 2 deviation variables. And this is the goal equation 1. We will see later that this equation will finally become a constraint. And we'll have to find these 2 deviation variables. Using these 2 deviation variables, we can make sure that the priority 1 will be met. We'll decide whether the priority 2 could be met depending on the case. We'll do the same thing with goal 2 equation. Goal 2 is saying that the portfolio should provide a total annual return of at least $9,000. Let's look at the annual return per share for this stock. We have a return of $3 per share from US oil and $5 per share from hub properties. That is 3U plus 5H. The goal is that the total annual return should be at least $9,000. Now we also add 2 more deviation variables. We have plus 2D plus and minus 2D minus. This is the way we formulate a goal programming model. We have these deviation variables for all goal equations. What about the definition of these variables? D2 plus is the amount by which the annual return is greater than the target value, which is $9,000. And D2 minus is the amount by which the annual return is less than the target value, which is $9,000. So you can see in this case, the variable of interest is actually D2 minus, because we want to keep the annual return at least $9,000. And D minus is a variable that reduces this target value. Accordingly, we want D2 minus to be minimum, the less the better. Otherwise, it will affect our goal. Finally, we write constraints. In this case, we only have one major constraint dealing with the limited fund. The client has $80,000. The stock price per share is $25 per US oil share and $50 per hub property share. So the total investment is 25 U plus 50 H. This one should not exceed the total available fund, which is $80,000. Okay. With all of this information, we can set up the goal programming model and solve the model. In general, to write a goal programming model, we write it this way. Again, you know, let's look at the goal number one again. The goal number one is to have the total risk index at most 700. And the variable of interest is D1 plus. Because D1 plus will actually increase the risk index. So therefore, we want to minimize this value. D1 minus will reduce the risk index, so any value should work fine. On the second goal, the variable of interest is D2 minus, because this variable will actually reduce the annual return, and we want to have the total annual return of at least $9,000. Hence, we also want to minimize D2 minus to keep the annual return of at least $9,000. So the goal programming can be written this way. Minimize P1 of D1 plus P2 of D2 minus. Now, this is not the actual mathematical expression. P1 refers to the priority 1, and P2 refers to the priority 2. So when we solve the model, we actually have to solve it for each priority. But this is how we write the programming model. And we have the first constraint, which is about the total fund available. And the second constraint actually deals with the goal one equation. I will rewrite the equation a little bit, because as you see in the book, the typical way to write constraints for linear programming model is to move all variables to the left-hand side, and only keep constant number or zero on the right-hand side. In this case, we move D1 plus and D1 minus to the left-hand side. They become minus D1 plus and plus D1 minus. We do the same with goal 2 equation. I move all variables to the left hand side, minus 2d plus and plus 2d minus. Finally, all of these variables are non-negative. So we have UH, D1 plus, D1 minus, D2 plus, D2 minus, all non-negative, or should be greater than or equal to zero. So this is how we write a programming model in a standard mathematical form. Thank you, and bye now.